أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد. Concerning the third and final lecture for today, which is concerning the honeymoon period. As we mentioned in the last session, there's no honeymoon in the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal for the nikah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got married to one of his wives. She was in Ethiopia, Abyssinia, Habasha, and he was in Al-Madinah. So there's no honeymoon period where a person has to go for a vacation, or a person has to take a trip, or he takes off from work. If he wants to do that, he can do it. But there's not a honeymoon the way the non-Muslims perceive the honeymoon. As for the days immediately after the nikah, then everyone should try to make a consistent and perpetual jihad to keep their marriage like that period. New, vibrant, and exciting. Because those are the best days of the marriage in terms of the emotions. A lot of times at the beginning, husband is seeing the best of the wife and she's seeing the best of what he has to offer. After a few months, that period wears off. And then the reality sets in. He comes home from work. He's tired, he's hungry, and he makes demands. She makes a lot of efforts to prepare the food. But once he gets used to that food, he may not be as appreciative. And then she stops giving the effort. And then before you know it, they are not on the same page. So that beginning period is an important period. It's a period that the couples should always try to revive by doing different things that come to us in the Quran and the Sunnah. And that also could just be borrowed from what we know works for other people. So concerning this honeymoon period, or when the people first get married, there are a lot of things to do. I mean, a lot of things from what the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam left for us. First thing we want to mention, when he got married, what they call the Laylatul Dakhl, the night in which he was going to have relationships with his wife and consummate with the wife. He used to, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, take into consideration the emotional state of the lady. He, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, told and showed us how to have rahmah for the girl, and not to be on the caveman minhaj. The caveman minhaj where the guy is just thinking about me, myself, and I'll be myself and I, and that's it. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was always like that, but especially on this particular day. He was gentle, he was easy, he was understanding. You can get that individual, ikhwani, who doesn't have fiqh in the religion. We talked about the basic fiqh of marriage. Fiqh is comprehension. Fiqh is comprehension. Knowing how to do things, how to apply things. Someone came and they said that their mother is giving them a hard time about getting married, about the mixing of the sexes, and they're fighting. So the mother doesn't want there to be separation. But she finally came to the conclusion, okay, we can have them separated, but no barrier. Okay, that's better than the mixing. So you made a lot of progress. And sometimes you have to give up something in order to get something. That's fiqh. Knowing how to give up and what to give up, what not to give up, and how to proceed. Some people are not like that. From the sunnah, no doubt, in marriage is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam put his head on the lap of his wife, Aisha. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to allow Aisha to comb his hair as a gesture of familiarity, being familiar with each other. And also, it's a romantic thing, being close like that. But if a man is going to marry the woman for the very first time, taking her out of a house, and then he says to her, hey, come, you want to comb my hair? Can I put my head on your lap? That's the caveman style. He can come and say, but it's the sunnah, it's the sunnah. But it's not the sunnah for her right now. So look at how the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on the night of consummation, what had happened. And a lot of things happened, all during that time. There was a companion, her name is Asma bint Yazid, radiallahu anha. She said, I prepared Aisha for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Very young girl. I made her beautiful. I put her clothes on and I got her ready for the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when the Prophet came to her, there were other women who were in the room with us, but I was sitting next to Aisha. So Rasulullah came sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with a big glass or vessel of milk, a big one. And he drank from that vessel of milk. And then he gave it to Aisha. The lady who prepared her said she put her head down and she didn't drink and she was uncomfortable and he was shy. She was shy. The lady said, so I poked her in her side and said, take it and drink it. She had to tell the young girl, take it and drink it. And you have to remember they had been married already. They were married when she was younger than that. But now is the day of consummating. But she's still young. So the lady poked her in the side and told her, drink it, drink it. So the lady drank it. Aisha drank it. And then Rasulullah told Aisha, give it to your friend, to the lady who was taking care of you. The lady said, no, Ya Rasulullah, you take it back and drink and give it to me. So the Prophet ﷺ took it from Aisha and he drank it and gave it to that lady. The lady took the drink and where the Prophet put his lip, not where Aisha put her lips, she searched for where the Prophet put his lips and she drank it. Now that's really important because it goes to show the permissibility of a tabarruk with Rasulullah ﷺ in his person, his sweat, his lips, the water from his wudu, making a tabarruk. That lady did it. And also, it goes to show the level of love and respect and appreciation that the companions had for him because she did that in front of Aisha, who was his wife. But Aisha knows that that companion lady, she has the love of the Muslim for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Doesn't enter in her head jealousy, you're disrespecting, nothing in her head. It's the normal, natural love that any and every Muslim would have for al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So after she drank it, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to that lady, give it to your friends who are here helping the situation. So those women were shy. They were watching what was happening. And they said, no, Ya Rasulullah, we don't want it. He told them sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la tajma'na ju'an wa kadhiba. Don't combine being hungry and lying at the same time. You people know you're hungry because we're poor people. We're poor. The Muslim community won't have a lot of money. When you get some free food, some free milk, you need to get with the program because you don't know when you're going to eat it again. So now is not the time to be shy. Now is the time to be happy, to rejoice. And plus, you know, you're hungry. So it goes to show if a Muslim is hungry, he visits someone and they say, you want to eat? Or they offer him something to eat. You want to ride? Don't be shy and say, no, I don't want to ride. And then you have to walk all the way over there and it's hot. And while you're walking, you say, I wish I would have said it. He told that those ladies, don't combine being hungry and lying, two bad things. Go ahead and eat or drink. So hadith, ikhwani, it goes to show how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did what? He brought something to his wife as a gift on this tough night for her. It's not an easy night for her. It's a night in which she's going to be extremely nervous. So the man, the sunnah is to take that into consideration. Now, in preparing this part of my lectures, I don't want to get too deep in that stuff. And a lot can be said, important stuff, that if older brothers were here, some of our younger brothers, I would discuss it freely and open with you. But we have some real little guys here. I mean, we have some real little guys here. And I don't know if I was speaking like this, you know, isharat, if you guys would understand. But the point is, there is a lot of information of what to do on the night of consummation. And what we don't do is the caveman minhaj. And the Muslims are on that caveman minhaj, where we come from. Africans, Arabs, Asians, we're like that. But the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was gentle. He was gentle. Also, in this so-called honeymoon period, or the beginning, very important sunnah, ikhwani, and that is the sunnah of making dua and starting off that marriage with the dua. When that lady finally becomes under your authority, your ishraf and your ismah, as your woman now, your queen, as your girl. Now, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught the people that once that happens, you have to start that relationship off seeking Allah's divine pleasure and protection in dua. He would sallallahu alayhi wa sallam take his wife after the nikah. He would grab her by the head, the forehead, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he would say, Bismillah, Allahumma inni as'aluka khayraha wa khayra ma jabaltaha alayhi wa a'udhu bika min sharriha wa min sharri ma jabaltaha alayhi. Oh Allah, I'm asking you for the good of this girl, the good that you put inside of her, and the good that you put her upon. And I seek refuge in the evil of the girl and the evil that you put her upon. So as I mentioned in the first session, for someone to come and say, if the people were really on the sunnah in this masjid, why are they talking about love and marriage? It's because love and marriage is from our religion. And in love and marriage are many issues connected to our aqeed as well. Like this hadith, it's from those hadith that prove and support Allah Ta'ala is the creator of good and Allah is the creator of evil. There are some deviant groups, the Mu'tazila, other than them, they said that the good is all from Allah, but the evil is from the shaitan. No, everything is from Allah in creation. Everything, nothing happens except by Allah's qadr, by Allah's permission, by Allah allowing it to happen. And from the proof that evil comes from Allah is that the sunnah is to ask Allah Azza wa Jal to protect you from the evil in that girl and the evil that Allah put upon her. Another hadith dua shows that you ask Allah to protect you from her evil and her from your evil as well. You from her evil and her from your evil as well. So that particular sunnah is critical and it's extremely important. And very seldom if the man, the young man, is going to get married and things like that, he's thinking about other things that are important, and it's easy for this sunnah to pass him by because his mind is preoccupied with other things. Those other things are really important, but the sunnah is to get off on a good start. Similar to that, the cousin of that adab is the issue of the salat. It is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the man, after making dua, he should make salat with his wife. From the prayers that are the sunnah is the salat of nikah, the salat of getting married. And the salat of getting married has two dalils that come from the companions. There was a man by the name of Abu Sayyid. He was the slave of Abu Usaid, and he was a slave when he got married. He was mamluk, a slave. He got married to a woman and he invited some of the companions over. He invited the ulama, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abu Dharr al-Ghaffari, and Hudhaifa ibn al-Yaman. May Allah be pleased with all of them. They came over and they decided to pray amongst themselves. When they were about to pray, Abu Dharr al-Ghaffari stood in the front in order to pray. And then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said to the slave, you lead us in salat. You, not him. Abu Dharr, without saying anything, got in the line with the three companions. And that man was a slave. The reason why they did that is because of the hadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la ya'ummu ar-rajul fi baytihi wa sultanihi. No man should be led in salat in his own house or his sultan. It's his business, it's his office, it's his house. Nobody has the right to come and lead him in the salat. His father, his uncle, the sheikh, whoever, his teacher, no one. He should be the one who says, go ahead, you lead. Now, if he can't recite the Quran, he's a new Muslim, that's a different issue. But he knows how to pray. The imam who just led the salat, and he's going to leave us tomorrow. May Allah Azza wa Jal send him back allowing to arrive safely and giving the khair of helping us through Ramadan. He reads the Quran, he knows the Quran. He doesn't have the right just to get up and go in front of the people in someone else's house. So that man, he led the people in the salah. After that, the companions told him, they said, When your wife comes to you after this, when she comes, you should take her and make dua for the good that is in her. Seek refuge for the evil that's in her. And ask for the good that is in you. And ask Allah to protect her from the evil that's in you. And then pray with your wife to rak'at. For verily, that's what the Prophet used to do, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So there's another hadith, an athar of the companions that's authentic, that shows on the night of consummating the marriage, again, you have to abandon, avoid the caveman style, and you have to do those nice things. Give something to drink, do something easy. Different cultures, no problem. Some cultures, they give you that pink drink with milk in it. No problem. No problem. You want to drink this, you want to drink that, no problem. You make the salat, and all of those issues are cutting the ice issues. And how do we cut the ice? You know, calm things down. We calm things down based upon the deen, what the Prophet's sunnah showed us, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wasallam. On this night and during this particular time, another issue is the issue of having relations. Something many people don't know about the sunnah, and that is, if you want to be a person from the sunnah, from Ahlus Sunnah, and you're one of those people who really want to try to practice as much as you can from the sunnah, then you should know, Ummatul Islam, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to consummate the marriage first, and then he had the walima later. He usually had the walima 3 days after consummating the marriage. The way we do it now is the opposite way. Many people don't know, as a matter of fact, if you get married to a man's family and you tell them, hey, the sunnah is, I consummate, and then later we'll do the walima. He'll take his hat off and throw it on the ground and say, you're disrespecting me, what's wrong with you? The sunnah is to have relations first, and then after that three-day period, he used to, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, have the walima. Why the three-day period? There's no honeymoon, but those are the days where he's paying attention to the wife. Marries a virgin girl, he's going to be with her for 7 days. If he has more than one wife, it's going to be the girl who had been married already for 3 days. So the sunnah is, in consummating the marriage, to consummate first and have the walima. Do you have to do that? That's the sunnah. It's the sunnah. But the uruf and the culture is the other way. And other variations are okay. Because we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he got married to Aisha, and there was an extended period of time and there was no consummation. So the girl wants to finish her studies, no problem. All of that is easy, it's open, it's from the culture, no problem. But for the one who has the ability, the father who understands, from the young man, the daughter who understands, that's the sunnah. And in that sunnah is ibadah. Maybe that thing will get you over the hump, Yawm al-Qiyamah. Maybe that thing will cause the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to let you receive his shafa'ah, Yawm al-Qiyamah. You know the hadith I told you before, Sulaiman, when he, salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi, when he had relationships, his desire was, I'm going to have relationships so that each one of these ladies are going to bring forth a mujahid fi sabilillah. That's a sunnah that's gone. That's his niyyah. So if a person makes his niyat with these kinds of things as a reward, his niyat is to get a reward, sadaqah. He said, "Fi budri ahadikum sadaqah." If one of you have relationships with his wife, it's sadaqah, sadaqah. Also concerning the consummating process, there is the issue of a nadhafa. And this is something, again, that fathers have to be on top of their sons. And the older people in our community, we have to take these youngsters and we have to talk to them straight up. How the Prophet used to do with his companions. Cleanliness is an important aspect of our religion. At-tuhur, shatrul iman. Cleanliness, ikhwani, is half of faith. To have good smells coming off of your body and stuff like that is our religion. They asked Aisha, what was the first thing that Prophet Muhammad began with, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if he came into his house? What was the very first thing that he would do in that house? She said the very first thing that he would do that caught our attention was he would use the miswak and clean his mouth. He's going to talk to her. He's going to be gentle with her. He's going to be affectionate with her, as he used to kiss his wife, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he went out, when he was in his house. He had that affection. She could have mentioned anything. He prayed two rakat. He gave salams. He sat and asked everyone how they were doing. What came to her mind is the very first thing that he did when he came in the house is he cleaned his teeth. So that's an indication that the lady, she has just as much right as the husband expects cleanliness from his wife. Cleanliness, dirtiness is a mushkila. Lady that has to deal with a man who doesn't know hygiene is a mushkila. Mushkila. Just like the man who has to deal with a woman. So it's the responsibility of the women, educate our girls in those home economics and those types of issues. And it's definitely for the men. And don't feel that this is a taboo, something that you as the dad, you can't talk about this. It's something that needs to be addressed. So he was like that in terms of consummating the marriage. You want that lady to come, and that's the Muslim lady, especially from our cultures. Our cultures, our women are like that. You come into that house, you're going to smell the atar and the bukhur. You're going to smell the room. You're going to smell that piddle. That's our women. I like that. The women and the men. We go to the toilet. We make istinja. We make wudu. We're cleaning ourselves, washing our hands before we eat, so forth. We're changing our clothes. That's our religion. Our religion. Some people without the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla, it's a problem. So this is a night where the man has to be extra keen and heightened on this issue. Don't be on the caveman minhaj. The man traveled from London to Birmingham for this conference. He's staying in the masjid. Don't look at the brothers who are staying in the masjid. He's staying in the masjid 2-3 days. He didn't have an opportunity to shower because he's not home. He goes back to London and he wants to be with his wife on that time. Not like that, yahi. Is that haram? Because someone may come and say, is it haram? That's not the issue. Haram, not haram. Being considerate and cleanliness. On this night and during this time, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also taught concerning having relationships, that issue of dua. Simple, easy dua that the person, if he's going to have relationships with his wife, he said that the man should say. But it is not wajib, is highly recommended, and it's not haram for the wife to say it, for both of them to say it, and for the wife to remind him. Allahumma jannibna shaytan wa jannib shaytan ma razaqtana. Allah, protect us from the shaytan and protect shaytan, protect us from shaytan, me and my wife. And if you decree a child between us, Protect that child from the shaitan as well. That sunnah and that dua is also important, and it's something he paid attention to. And the companions used to take these jewels and these pearls, and they used to implement it, and they used to pass it on to the people that they were teaching. Concerning this issue of consummating for the brothers and the sisters in our community, one of the worst crimes in al-Islam is for the man to spread the intimate secrets of his wife and vice versa. The things that you do with your wife should not be discussed with anybody else. And one of the worst people you can discuss this with is, sometimes there's no insijam or harmony between the girl and the boy. There's some problems. They have trouble consummating, or there's something they don't like about each other physically. He cannot go to her mother, her sister, maybe even her father. He can't go and tell them those types of things directly. He has to have some level of haya and edip. He has to find another way to do that. Sharing the secrets, the intimate secrets from the major sins. Rasulullah looked at his companions who were sitting there, the men there and the women over there, and he said, it may be that some of you men discuss what you do intimately with your wife with other men. And everyone looked down and tried to avoid eye contact with each other and tried to avoid eye contact with the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. One brave soul from the companions, he said, Ya Rasulullah, yes, wallahi, the men do that and the women do that as well. The companions were human beings, radiallahu anhum, they're the best of the human beings. These mistakes used to happen because they had things from Jahiliyyah with them. Certain people were new to Islam. These things used to happen. Not all of the companions. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, those people, they would put their heads down out of embarrassment that there were some people doing that, but they were not the people who were doing that. The new Muslims, people like that, people living in the desert. Don't get a picture and an image. All of the companions were doing that. Kalla wallahi. Some of them. And some of them used to make mistakes. And they are the best. And we get benefits off of those mistakes. Actually, Ikhwani, it was a lady who said, Yes, Ya Rasulullah, the men do it and the women do it. It was a lady who said it. The men do it and the women. He told them, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, La taf'alu. Don't do that. The example of the person who does that is like the example of a shaitan who meets another shaitana in the middle of the street, and then he starts to have relationships with her in the broad daylight in front of everybody's eyes. So it is not cool, it is not halal, it is not okay for any woman to sit and to talk about the intimate issues unnecessarily about what's transpiring between her and her husband. It's not permissible for the man to do that as well, especially for the man, because he can't be there describing his wife to someone else. And that's one of the haq that the Muslim woman has over her husband, is that he has jealousy for his wife. Soon as he gets married, Ikhwani is going to have some jealousy for her. Maybe a type of jealousy that she didn't know before him. Her father was protecting her and her brothers were on her. But the husband is going to have that other kind of jealousy, that concern, that jealousy that's from our deen, but not the one that goes over the board, that goes, it's OTT, that one that's haram. He's spying on her and he's doubting her for no reason and he's accusing her with no dalil. That ghira is haram. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, inna min al-ghira ghiratun yubghiduha Allahu subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهِيَ غِيرَةُ الرَّجُلُ عَلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ مِنْ غَيْرِ رِبَةٍ. There is a jealousy that Allah hates. He hates it. And it is the jealousy that a man has for his wife when there's no reason to be jealous. He's insecure. He has issues. He has waswas. So as a result of that, everyone who is in his sphere of acquaintances, his brother, his father, his uncle, the neighbor, everybody, he's accusing his wife of stuff. And he knows if somebody were to come to him and say, by Allah, if you're wrong, you're going to lose your life. If you're wrong, your woman, your wife, you think she did. He knows the answer is, wallahi, she would never do anything. But he has those issues. So that type of ghira is not permissible. And that's a problem in our community. Some people are accusatory towards their wives. And there's no dalil for that. It's your insecurity. You have to deal with it. Also, Ikhwani, very important concerning the etiquette of consummating. The Prophet did many things on the day, the night of consummating. Things with his companions, things with his wife, and then in the morning he did certain things. So what is the sunnah? Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu ardahu. He described the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after the nikah, after the consummation. قال أولما رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذ بنى بزينب رضي الله عنها فأشبع المسلمين خبزا ولحما ثم خرج إلى أمهات المؤمنين فسلم عليهن ودعا لهن وسلمنا عليه ودعونا له فكان يفعل ذلك صبيحة بنائه. Anas ibn Malik said that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he consummated the marriage with his wife Zainab, he consummated, it was done. After the consummation was done, he came out to the Muslims and he did a walima for them. He gave them meat and he gave them bread. That was his sunnah. Consummation first and then the walima. He saw Abdurrahman ibn Auf in another incident. Abdurrahman ibn Auf, one of the 10 people promised Jannah, he came. Prophet Muhammad saw in his clothes a mark, something that was in his clothes. He said, what is that? Abdurrahman ibn Auf. Abdurrahman ibn Auf said, I got married, Ya Rasulullah. So he had the athar, the remnants of being with his wife on his clothes. The Prophet said, did you make a walima? He said, no. He said, then do a walima, even if it's with one small sheep. So that's a proof that Abdurrahman ibn Auf, he consummated before the walima. But it's up to the person who wants to follow the sunnah. Anas ibn Malik said, after he consummated with Zainab, radiallahu anhu, he gave the Muslims a walima. He gave them bread and meat. Bread and meat. He got married to another woman. He gave them some tamar mixed up with ghee, mixed up with flour. And they came and they ate that. So the walima doesn't have to be something extravagant. And also, it shouldn't be something that's crazy as well. And this is where the culture is important. I know a brother, you got married, or there's a situation, you get married, I'm a revert, I get married. I want to marry the girl, and after getting married to the girl, her family is behind her. Asian family, Somali family, Arab family, she has a family. I'm going to do the walima. What's the walima? The walima of the revert. I'm going to give them cornflakes. I'm going to give them some biscuits. I'm going to give them some chocolate. And then I'm going to say to them, hey, the sunnah. Not like that. For my revert brothers, not like that. Do you have to go and borrow 10,000 pounds and go into debt to do what their culture does? No, you push their culture back. But you have to do enough to show the father you appreciate the fact he did what he did. You know, these culture aspects, many things that we do, it's not haram. People in East Africa, Kenya, I don't know if Somalis do that, but I know in Kenya, you want to marry the girl. When they're going to marry the girl, the husband, maybe the husband along with his friends, they go to the house of the girl in order to get the girl. And she's inside the house, and the brothers meet them at the door outside of the house. They say, we come for your sister. We come for your daughter. They say, how much you going to pay? They don't mean that, selling your daughter. It's a little thing. Sometimes it gets escalated because one of the brothers is a bit difficult. And one of the people on the other side is a bit difficult. That's our sister. We're not letting her go like that. Come on, give us the girl. And it can be a problem. Is that haram, that process? That thing is not haram. As long as it stays lighthearted and it's fun, no problem. No problem. But for that walima and things like that, these issues of the culture are okay. Just don't go against the religion and don't make it unnecessarily and unduly difficult upon yourself. So Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, he described that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he gave that simple walima after he consummated the marriage with our mother Zainab bintu Jash. May Allah ta'ala be pleased with her and all of the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as well as all of his companions. So, Ikhwani, in this issue of the nikah, as I mentioned, the chapter of nikah is one of the most important chapters in the Deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. We have in the Book of Allah a dastur, we have a constitution for the person to know how to do and how not to do and what's the process that should be followed. It's just there for the pickings, it's there for the taking, meaning the individual should equip himself and trying to get comprehension and understanding theoretically from what he learned in the books and also practically from people who already had that experience. So the main lesson here is follow the sunnah and approach the issue with knowledge. Allah Azza wa Jalla make the things easy for you. This is what we wanted to present, and now we'll deal with the questions. After the salat, two brothers came up to me. One Asian brother, he said, you mentioned doing your talk about the Niko, the people do the Niko. What's the Niko? I said, ask the people from Somalia. So if that brother comes to you, that's why he's coming to you. I didn't want to tell him what that was. Another brother mentioned, during your talk, you mentioned shaving the beard. Here in the UK, shaving the beard means taking it all off. I didn't mean that, and I even said it. I said there are some scholars who I don't agree with that position who said you can trim your beard. But none of them said that you can shave it all off. So you can't cut it all off, can't cut it all off. But they were of the opinion that you can trim it. And Allah knows best. So we just wanted to make that clarification. Tafadhal.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, the first question. It's from a sister. She said, you said there were five things needed at the marriage ceremony, but you only mentioned wali, witnesses, dowry, and consent. What was the fifth thing?
Good question, Amatullah, barakallahu fikum. The wali is one, two witnesses, two and three, the dowry, four, and the consent is five. And there are ikhtilaf in these issues between the scholars. Some add other things, but those are the five, inshallah, that we wanted to pay attention to here and to remind you, brothers and sisters, of.
Jazakallah khair. Second question, is masturbation haram or makruh? And a linked question to that, I have been told for something to be haram, the Quran or the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam need to explicitly say something is haram.
There's some ikhtilaf between the scholars concerning this issue of masturbation. There's some really details that should be studied properly without a person trying to follow his desires. First of all, there are those scholars who said that it's totally haram by the text of the Quran and the Sunnah. Those ayats of the Quran, like in Surah Al-Furqan, Ibadur Rahman, Alladhina Yamshuna Al-Ard Hawna, Allah describes the Ibadur Rahman. And he said, Alladhina La Yaznoon, those people, they don't make zina. And they don't have relationships except with their wives or what their right hands possess. And then Allah said, anything other than that is a sin. So masturbation is other than with your wife and other than with your right-hand possession. Great scholars like Al-Imam al-Shawkani, that man is a mountain of knowledge in this deen. He wrote a book about the permissibility of masturbation. But it doesn't seem like the proofs are on his side when you gather them all together. But there are those people who have that position. And then you have those scholars who said if an individual fears that he's going to fall into zina and he's overwhelmed with his desires, then that's better than making zina. And they gave him a rukhsa. But other scholars, the majority, rejected that. Because we have in the religion what tells us not to do that, what takes the place of that. And that is, oh, you young men, whoever has the ability to get married, then get married. Get married. For verily, it causes your eyes to be lowered and it protects your private part. Lastly, ikhwani, masturbation is a problem because the one who starts to do that, he gets caught in the snares and the grip of masturbating. He can harm himself. She can harm herself. That they throw themselves off of the equilibrium of what is natural. So then if they do get married, they'll be confronted with other problems. So it's better to avoid it and just to be patient. Avoid certain fools that may cause that to happen. Get yourself busy with something like lifting weights, jogging, running, things like that. Working out, grappling, jujitsu. Get yourself busy with things like that. May Allah Ta'ala help our Shabab with that issue.
Jazakallah khair. Next question. Is it haram if a woman refuses to sleep with her husband when he requests it?
Nah, it's haram. It's haram. The hadith said that any woman who refuses the request of her husband and she goes to sleep like that, then the malaik are angry with her. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam mentioned that if the man wanted to have relationships with the woman, even if she's baking the bread, she should come. Another hadith said, even if she's on the camel, she should come. The meaning of that hadith is to show, hey, you should comply with the wishes of your husband. But although that is the case, he can't rape her. Although that is the case, he can't be physical with her. Rape in this country, ikhwani, in this country is like FGM. It's like forcing your daughter to get married, forced marriage. Rape in this country is to have relationships with a woman and she didn't want that to happen. Even if she complied with you and she did it, she can call the popo and say, this is what happened. And if that's what happened, you're going to get arrested. They're going to arrest you and investigate you. So what should the man do? He shouldn't do that thing, it's my haq. He shouldn't do that. And plus the religion tells us, take into consideration the girl's emotional state. Had an argument with the girl, he's upset with her, she's upset with him. Sometimes that's the best formula to come back together. Sometimes that's the best way to do it. And sometimes it's the thing you shouldn't do. So the Nabi told the people, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, don't any of you hit your wife in the daytime as if she's a slave, and then come to at the end of the night, you want to have relationships with her. Take into consideration her mental state of mind. So he has the right not to be refused. But this is a great area now in this society. So what's the official statement here? The official statement is, if she refuses, then let her have to deal with Allah. He told the lady, you will not give Allah his rights until you give your husband his rights. So let her be asiya with Allah. As for you, being aggressive and forceful, don't do that. Don't do that.
JazakAllah khair. Next question. Do the parents of the bride or the parents of the groom need to be aware of the terms of the marriage contract before the marriage?
It's not wajib that they are aware of the terms. It's not wajib. But it's from respect that they are aware, especially issues that concern them. But if there are some issues that the husband and the wife, the bride and the groom, they deem is better that this is between you and me, and they let the witnesses know, the witnesses should know about that, then it's okay. So from the angle of respect, yes, but it's not something haram. It's not something haram.
JazakAllah khair. It was mentioned in one of the other lectures today that before marriage, you should be completely trustworthy and truthful to your future spouse. But what if your truthfulness is exposing past sins? Do you still mention them, and to what extent?
The person should not expose himself when it's not necessary. When it's not necessary, you shouldn't expose yourself. All of my ummah will be forgiven except those who broadcast. Who are the broadcasters? Those people who did sins and they went to sleep at night, Allah covered him. They woke up in the morning, they went and say, hey, I did this, I did that. So you don't reveal your sin, your defect, unnecessarily. But when it concerns marriage, you should let the people know what they need to know. It's their haq, it's her haq, it's his haq. You should let them know that a lady came with her daughter, and her daughter had a wig on. She had a pishia. Her hair fell out. She was bald-headed, radiallahu anha, bald-headed. She told the Prophet, ﷺ, my daughter has a wig. The Prophet said, no, let her not wear that wig. And let the man know what's going on. Now you can imagine how that's going to make the girl feel, the family feel. Because in most instances, the man's going to say, I don't think so. And you can understand why he would say that. Doesn't mean she's ugly. The one who has a pishia doesn't mean that. But it is a defect. So if it is something that's going to affect people, then there are certain things that should be divulged.
JazakAllah khair. Next question is, what is more stable in Islam, a love marriage or an arranged marriage?
Both sides, they work. There are some arranged marriages that are perfect. Perfect. They work perfectly. That is because the mother and the father on both sides, they knew what they were doing, and they saw the harmony and the potential between the two. And Allah put the barakah in it first and foremost. And then there are those love marriages that are catastrophic. They fell in love, it was a problem. And then the opposite holds true. There's the love marriage, and love marriage means the person chose the person for themselves. Not they fell in love before that, but they chose the person for themselves. Those work like Jannah on earth. And then the arranged marriage with the closest first cousin, it is catastrophic. So no one can say this is better or that's better. You get in when you fit in and you find a person who works for you. Love, arrange, just make sure you do your homework.
JazakAllah khair. There's a linked question to that. The question has said, The Sheikh talked about doing your research on the person you wish to marry. Outside of Islam, there's a practice called dating. What would be a halal way of dating?
There's no dating as such in the deen of Allah. The only dating that we may have is I have a daughter and I have sons, brothers of that daughter, and the brother, he wants to marry my daughter. And I know the society. I know the society. This is not the old country. This is the UK. So I make my daughter available and accessible to get to know him, and she gets to know him, and he gets to know her under the supervision and the presence of myself at times, my son at times, my sons at times, all of us together. Let them be exposed as much as possible under your supervision, under your watchful eye. Obviously, the boys and sons have to be mature. They have to be on the same page. But I believe that they should be allowed to try to get to know each other as much as possible. And sometimes that works and sometimes it doesn't. The other situation, you meet the family, they meet the girl, she's available, he's available, that's it, well, we get a married. Problem, it didn't work. And sometimes that does work. And that's why it's important that the person tries to do his best, which is trying to be a righteous individual, him, his wife, family, and we hope for the best. The Prophet got divorced, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It didn't work with certain people. His companions got divorced. Divorce is a viable way of getting out of a marriage that doesn't work. As it relates to dating, that's the dating in Islam. Supervision and giving the people exposure to the other person while you're watching, while you're there. As for being alone, then this is something that should be avoided.
JazakAllah khair. There's a few questions about the wali and about the parents giving permission. I'll combine them together, inshallah. The questioner is asking, what's your advice to the parents who refuse the young ones from getting married in the name of culture, tradition, tribe, etc.? And there's a linked question which says that, what if your parents refuse for you to marry a righteous person and instead want you to marry someone who isn't practicing?
As we mentioned, Ikhwani, the hadith is clear. إِذَا جَاءَكُم مَن تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقُهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوا تَكُون فِتْنَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٍ كَبِيرٍ. If someone comes to you and they want to get married, a boy or a girl, if he comes to you and he wants to get married and you're pleased with his deen, you're pleased with his character, then marry him. If you don't do it, it's going to be fitna, he said, in the earth, not in your house. It's going to be fitting in the earth. A lot of fitna and facade. You're helping to create a problem. You're helping to create a problem. So in that case, the mother and the father, if someone comes like that for the boy or someone is available for their daughter, then it's their responsibility to cooperate in that issue. If the parents want the son or the daughter to marry someone who is not religious and they disobey them in that, they're not considered to be he's not disobedient. He is not disobedient.
Next question, also linked to the wali. What is the order in the family of the wali after the father?
There's ikhtilaf concerning that. The father, the grandfather, the uncle from his side. The father, the grandfather, the uncle from the father's side. As long as the girl has someone who's responsible for her, from her lineage, from her blood, someone who has her best interests at heart, then they're not sinning. The reason why the scholars gave that tartib is so that there's no fitna, no drama between the uncle and the son. The uncle says, I have more right. That's my brother's daughter. The son says, no, that's my sister. So the madhab said this, that. But there's no hadith that said that. Allahumma illa. The Prophet, he mentioned, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the father's brother, the father's brother is like the father. The father's brother is like the father. So if the father's out of the picture, then you have to honor your father's brother. So they took that hadith and said, so he's the one who should be responsible. Others says, no, the grandfather, if he's there, he's like the father. So it's an issue of ikhtilaf. It's an issue of ikhtilaf. For the sisters who don't have relatives who are Muslims, then the imam of the masjid or some responsible, trustworthy individual from the community, from the Muslims, can be and should be hawali.
Jazakallah khair. The questioner asks, how is a guy supposed to know how to contact the sister's wali without talking to the sister? And what's the correct way of approaching a sister?
There's an ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah about the lady who has been divorced 3 times and she's in her iddah for the 3rd irrevocable divorce. Allah in that ayah allowed a man to say to her directly some words, but in the side way to let her know he's interested in her. When your iddah is finished, holler at me. So she knows. When your iddah is done, how much more time before your iddah? He says something that was, he can't come and say, I want to marry you. He has to say in a sideways type of way. So he allowed the man under that circumstance to do that. So if he's dealing with a girl, he doesn't know where she comes from. He doesn't know anything about her family. He doesn't know anything about her. But she caught his eye, and he's a decent guy, and she's acting and behaving in a decent way. He should try his level best to find out about her and her people without approaching her. But out of necessity, if there's no other alternative, then it's permissible for him to ask her something like that or get some lady to ask her some way like that. But he should try to exhaust all of the avenues. Why? Because if it was your daughter, you wouldn't want someone stepping to her like that. You wouldn't want someone just approaching her like that. And the companions, they mentioned, Nahana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and itkallama al-nisa illa bi idhni awliya'ihinna. He prohibited us from talking to the girls set with the wali. You have to have permission from the wali. So if it's necessity, no other alternative, you exhausted all avenues, then you can say something respectful, try to find out.
Jazakallah khair. Next question, I think you already mentioned this in your lecture. The question is, can a woman include in the contract that the husband cannot marry any other woman?
Some of the people say no, they can't do this. There was a lady who was a good friend of Aisha. Her name was Burayra. Aisha came and paid the money to let that lady become free. She had a husband, and her husband's name was Mughith. He was a slave, she was a slave. When she won her freedom, and she went and paid the people the money, the people said, okay, we take the money and she is free. She's yours, free. But the wilaya of her is for us. Anything happens to us, we get her inheritance or something like that. Aisha said, okay. She told the Prophet what had happened, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when he heard that, he went out to the people and he said, أَيُّ شَرْطٍ لَيْسَ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ بَاطِلُ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِئَةَ شَرْطٍ. Any condition that is not in the book of Allah, any condition that someone made that's not in the book of Allah, even if it's 100 conditions, it's rejected because it's not in the Quran. So some of the scholars came and said, how can you ask someone, you can't live, you can't move here, you can't marry this, you can't do that. Allah's earth is spacious. He can live wherever he wants to live. And who are you, lady, to reduce that? Who are you to stop him from marrying another lady? But the other scholar said, no. The Prophet, he came, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ali ibn Abi Talib was thinking about marrying the daughter of Abu Jahl. The Prophet said, I do not make haram what Allah made halal, plural marriage. I don't make it haram. But if Ali ibn Abi Talib wants to marry the daughter of the enemy of Allah, then let him divorce my daughter. I'm not making it haram. You want to marry her and some other one, you can. But you're not going to marry her with my daughter because she's the daughter of the enemy of Allah. So my daughter's going to suffer. So that's what the lady is saying. The lady is not saying to her husband, hey, plural marriage is haram. No, you can do plural marriage, but you can't do it with me. So do you agree to that? She didn't take his arm and do like this with him. She said, did you agree? And then he has stars in his eyes at that moment because he wanted to get married. He said, yeah, I agree. And then after they get married and time goes on, he say, I want to get married again. She said, you remember the condition that you agreed to? And the Prophet, he mentioned, al-Muslimun ala shurutihim. Muslims take care of their conditions. So in this case, the strongest opinion, inshallah, is if he agrees to that stuff, he has to live up to it.
Jazakallah khair, there's a linked question. If this condition is not in the marriage contract, can a woman ask to leave the marriage if her husband marries a second wife?
Naam ya ikhwani, it's allow for the lady to do that. It's allow for her to get a khula. He said about the people give the khula or get the khula. Al-mukhtali'atu munafiqatu ummati. Those women who seek khula are the hypocrites of our ummah. Ayyuma imra'atin sa'alat zawjaha at-talaq min ghayri dhi ba'sin fa haramun 'alayha ra'ihatul jannah wa inna ra'ihataha la tujid min masirati kadha wa kadha. Any woman who asks her husband for khula without a just reason, the fragrance of Jannah is haram for her. Although the fragrance can be smelled from so long of a distance. So she shouldn't ask a khula for a trivial reason, a small reason. But what she's asking the khula for here is, you broke the contract. You made an agreement. And I told you in the beginning, I'm sensitive to this. I don't want this. I can't handle this. And even if I could handle it, I can handle it, but I don't want it. And you agreed. So once he broke the contract, she has the right to get a khula in that issue.
The question is, if a woman marries a man and he passes away, and then she gets married a second time, who does she stay with in Jannah? And is there a hadith or evidence in regards to this?
Issues like that, ikhwani, who does she stay with in Jannah? We can't mention the answer unless you have a dalil, because it's from the unseen. And it did happen. Ummu Darda, she asked the Prophet that question, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, a man, a lady is married and has been married to multiple men. There were some companion women who had been married to four or five men, six men. That happened. Radiallahu anhunna. So if she had multiple partners and husbands in the dunya, who would she be with? Yawmul Qiyamah. He mentioned in an authentic hadith, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, al-mar'atu ma akhir ba'liha fil jannah. The lady will be with her last husband in the jannah. She will be with her last husband that she was with in this dunya in the jannah. All of them in jannah. But what if the first one was the best one? Abu Bakr married the woman, Umar married after him, and then Ali married after that. And she died on Ali. And Abu Bakr is better than Ali, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. So shouldn't she belong to Abu Bakr? Kalla. Because in Jannah, there's none of that. Hasid and haqd. You know, you don't have that person, hasid. None of that. Allah Ta'ala will take those stuff out of the hearts of the people, and it's no problem. No problem. So that's the answer with the last husband.
Jazakallah khair. Next question is, what is the punishment for wearing makeup outside of your home?
The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned, أَيُّمَا إِمْرَأَةٍ خَرَجَتْ إِذَا خَرَجَتْ الْمَرْأَةُ مِنْ بَيْتِهَا إِسْتَشْرَفَهَا الشَّيْطَانِ. If the lady comes out of her house, shaitan beautifies her. And that's if she comes out the right way with hijab, jilbab, niqab, and she's covered from head to toe, shaitan is still going to beautify her. He's going to still beautify her. So he said if the lady were to put on perfume, she's committing zina. She's a zania. So the one who's making makeup and she's attracted and making herself attractive to the people, then she gets that ruling as well. الَّذِينَ يُحِبُّونَ أَن تُشِيَ الْفَاحِشَ فِي الَّذِينَ آمِنُوا. Those people who love like for fahisha to be spread amongst the believer, Allah Ta'ala said, tell them about a grievous punishment that has been prepared. So it's permissible for her to go outside with makeup. It's permissible. But she has to cover up her face. She leaves outside and, you know, in America, we call them a garage. Your garage is where you park your car. The garage, you park your car. And your house is connected to your house. So she comes out of the kitchen. She gets into the car. Has black windows in the van. She has makeup, no problem. She goes to the party. Nobody see her, smell her, no problem. But if she's in the street and people see her, then this is what is not permissible.
The next question is, why is it that women are never directly addressed in the Quran?
That's not true. Allah Ta'ala addresses women in the Quran. وَقُلِ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْدَدْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفِظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ. Tell the believing women to do this and do that. Cover up yourselves, lower your gazes. يَا نِسَاءَ النَّبِيِّ لَسْتُنَّ كَأَحْدٍ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ. O women of the Prophet, wives of the Prophet, you are not like the other believe. You are not like the other. You are not like the other women. When we talk about compatibility in marriage, al-kafa'a, compatibility. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, and He started with the women's description: al-khabithatu al-khabithin, wal-khabithun al-khabithat, wal-tayyibati al-tayyibin, wal-tayyibun al-tayyibat. He said that the pure women are for the pure men. The dirty men, women for the dirty men, and so forth, so on. And then we have the issue in the language of the Arabs, the language in our religion. Prophet said, Ikhwani sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-nisa shaqa'iqur rijal. Women are the twins of the men. Everything that we have to do, they have to do. Everything that we do, they have to do. So although Allah Ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, and that's masculine, by default, the woman is in there. The woman is in there. Ya ayyuhannas. He's addressing men and women, Arabs and non-Arabs, the older and the youngster, the rich and the poor, and so forth and so on. And even if there were no ayats that said, addressing the women, kana madha, what's the problem? What's the problem? Hafiz Abu Bakr, can you give me an ayat where Allah Ta'ala addressed the women? But other than the Prophet's wives. So there are many ayahs like that. But even if Allah didn't address the women, well, what's the problem? Where do we stop with that? Why didn't Allah choose an African-American to be the Prophet? The next person comes and says, why didn't Allah choose? Where do we do that? So I don't think this is what the sister is saying. I think what the sister is, what this person is asking is, can you just benefit us? But don't let anyone have something in their heart and their mind about that.
Jazakallah khair. Next question is, what is the ruling for adoption if you can't have your own child? Also, do you have to make the child a mahram?
Adopting, as we know it in this society, is not permissible. It was abrogated with the situation with Zayd ibn Thabit, Zayd ibn Haritha, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it's permissible in the way we have it in this culture. But if someone wants to take custody of a child, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ana wa kafir al-yateem kahatini yawm al-qiyamah. I will be with the one who takes responsibility for an orphan like this. So he takes an orphan and he's the kafil, he's responsible, supervising. That's permissible. But that individual can marry his daughters. An individual is this and that and this. So adopting where they take your name and they inherit from you, these things should be avoided.
Jazakallah khair. Next question is it permissible to have a nikah whereby the consummation is delayed in order for the sister to get to know her spouse? And is it also permissible to delay the payment of the mahr?
Yeah, all of that is permissible, ikhwani, if they want to delay so that they can get to know each other. And if it doesn't work out, they get out of it. That's permissible. And it's also permissible to delay giving the dowry as well. There was a companion who his portion of the battle of Khaybar was decided. It was coming out to about 100,000 dirhams or dinars. He got married to a lady and they didn't decide what the dowry was going to be. He never said, I'm going to give you this dowry, that dowry. He never said it. And then he was dying. So he brought the people before him and he said, bear witness that I never gave her her dowry. Her dowry is my portion of the war, the booty from Khaybar. And it was 100,000 dirham, dinars, dirham. When the Prophet heard that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the best dowry is the easy dowry. But he allowed that. He allowed that. So they delayed it until his deathbed. And he gave it to her.
JazakAllah khair. Next question is from a sister. What is the best way of seeking a husband through a safe halal way if you're not connected to a community?
I think you just do the best that you can. I mean, everybody is connected here. Everybody is connected some way. Even if the lady is in Anchorage, Alaska, 6 months daytime, 6 months nighttime. If she lives out there and she wants to marry someone, there's someone who knows that person, and there are people who know that particular person. So just try to get with individuals or communities that you find, you trust them, the way they are, the way they do business. And then ask them to help you to get married.
JazakAllah khair. Next question is, what is the ruling of a woman wearing designer and attractive abayas and dresses and also wearing abayas that show the shape of her body when she leaves her home?
It's not permissible. The Prophet told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sinfan min ummati min ahli nari lam arahuma ba'd wa dhakara minhuma نساء كاسيات عاريات مائلات مميلات رؤوسهن كأسنمة البخت المائلة. There are two groups of people from my ummah who are going to be punished, and I never saw them yet. And one group, he said, were a group of women who were dressed, but they were naked. They had their hair like the humps of camels, and they walked in a seductive fashion. So they're dressed, but they're not dressed. So having a designer jilbab, there's nothing wrong with a designer jilbab. But when the designer jilbab or the non-designer jilbab has things that are making a lama', it's glittering and a lot of things are going on, then it defeats the whole purpose of the jilbab. It's drawing attention.
JazakAllah khair. Next question is, at the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, men and women used to pray in the masjid without a physical barrier, where men were at the front lines and the women were at the rear of the masjid. What is the reason why now we insist on a physical barrier, and what is the evidence for this?
In Usul al-Fiqhwani, and I want these questions to be connected to my what's the name, because there's no limit to this thing. Concerning this marriage thing, the three sessions that I put forward, inshallah, let's deal with those issues first, okay? As the person said, there was no barrier during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now, should we or should we not have a barrier? There is something in Usul al-Fiqh that is called al-musalih al-mursala. Al-musalih al-mursala. It is a way of determining if something is halal or haram, or if something should be done or shouldn't be done. It is the thing that doesn't have a dalil for it from the Quran and the Sunnah as such. But it's that thing, if you do it, there's going to be some benefit as a result of you doing it. And if you don't do it, it's going to be harmful. There's no ayat or hadith told you to do that. But if you do it, it's going to be some benefit for doing it. And if you don't do it, it's going to be some harm. But there are conditions for this to be used. And one of the most important conditions is, if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had the ability to do it and he didn't do it, then you shouldn't do it. If he didn't have the ability to do it, then okay, that's one of the conditions. This microphone is from the Masalih al-Mursala. If you do it, it's going to be some benefit. And if you don't do it, it's going to be some harm. Month of Ramadan, we're going to read, how those women going to hear what we're doing? How are they going to know? There's benefit. But the Prophet didn't have the ability to do it. So it's permissible. That watch. He didn't have the permit. So there's people who say, okay, but what about this? Why is that a bid'ah? Why is it? Hey, this is Musalih al-Mursala. Take it easy. Relax. Yeah, it is a bid'ah. But not that bid'ah you're talking about. So with the barrier, he had the ability, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to take a qumash or some material, and he could have put it between the men and the women. He had the ability. Abu Bakr, Uthman, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, Abu Talha al-Ansari, you rich people, you Muslims, give me some money, bring your qumash, your material, we're going to do this. He could have done that, but he didn't do it. He could have put rolls on the line, but he didn't do it. Okay, you go. Take this string over there. You tie it over there. You take that string. You take that string. We want to keep the line straight. He didn't do it. He had the ability to do it. So since he didn't do it, and he had the ability to do it, don't do it. Don't do it. But if it's a masjid that does that, we're not going to make a big deal about that. Ikhwani, we got big fish to fry. We have some big fish to fry. One of the things, a big problem disturbing, is the lack of etiquette in how to deal with each other when we disagree. I'm Salafi, inshallah. That guy over there, he's not Salafi. He sees it a different way. I'm going to have some dialogue with him. I'm not going to hate that guy. I think it's disturbing, and I'm going to end with this. I think it's disturbing. Something is wrong with the Salafi person who doesn't realize. He doesn't realize the Dawah to Salafiyah is inclusive. It's for everybody in the world. It's for the one who's Brewi and Deobandi and Sufi. It's for your relatives. It's everybody. This thing about we can't sit with innovators. We can't sit with... So who's going to get the Sunnah? Who's going to get the Dawah? You don't sit with them at a particular time and place, conditions. It's not like you're doing it with the occult mentality. Us, and we're against them. So we have to have some way of having adab when we have ikhtilaf. They want to put the blanket, the barrier. They want to do that? No, I think there are more issues that are more important, like, the challenges of our youth, the foreign policy of this government, the internal policies of this government that affect us, so many issues. So I'm a bit disturbed at what we hear these days, where the people say, don't help the people of them because Hamas, Ikhwan Muslimin. Akhi, this is not the time for Ikhwan Muslimin Kalam, Sufi Kalam, ain't the time for that. Muslims are being slaughtered right now. This is the time for us to cry for those people and be concerned. What kind of Dawah are you talking about? So have some adab in these issues. Everything of the Sunnah is important, but some things are more important than others. And we don't make wala wa bara on these issues. Thanks, Ikhwani, for your good listening. You brothers and sisters, may Allah Azza wa Jal protect all of you, give you khayr in the dunya and the hereafter. And may Allah Azza wa Jal bless all of you for your efforts in coming here, inshallah, to participate in the program. Barakallahu feekum wa assalamu alaikum.
A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani rajeem. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم